Well, good morning, Glue Troopers, and welcome to the Tarbus. Today, we're going to continue our air race series. We're going to talk about Jimmy Doolittle, and just recently finished reading the book I Could Never Be So Lucky Again, which was written by Doolittle with Carol Glines. And to say that General Doolittle had a colorful career is to understate colorful careers. So we're going to take a real quick look at his background, focus on his air racing, and then we'll take a quick look at the tail end of his, well, the post-racing career. I wouldn't say the tail end because his career pretty much went his entire life. Jimmy Doolittle's born in 1896 in Alameda, California, but when he's a small child, his father decides that they should move up to Alaska. They had the gold rush going on up there. And his father wasn't a prospector, but he realized there would be considerable business in providing services to the prospectors. And so his father goes up there and is engaged in a series of businesses. Well, Jimmy, who, although we always think of him as being bald, he actually had gold, like curly locks that hung down. His mother didn't want to cut them. She thought they were adorable. I don't think he cared too much for him, but he was left to his own devices a lot. And while he was living in Alaska as a young man, he got a great love affair with the great outdoors. He tinkered with a lot of things, became very mechanical. In fact, he would have a workshop and tinker on stuff his entire life, but he would later admit that that was more of his way to relax, because he never, in his own words, he never really made anything in his tinkerings worthy of note, although he would make incredible leaps and bounds for science at work. Eventually, after some years, his mom's had enough of Alaska. She brings him back down to the lower 48. Father eventually followed. But in 1909 is when he's introduced to the airplane at an air show. He is just completely enamored with it. He tries to learn everything he can about aviation, and he's just a young teenager. He gets a magazine that has instructions on how to build your own glider, and he builds it and jumps off about a 15-foot cliff with it and bangs the tail, which renders it immediately unflyable, and careens into the ground, somehow manages to get up, dust himself off, rebuilds the glider, decides it'd be better if he towed it behind a car, grabs a friend who has access to a car. They try to tow the glider, crashes again. Then he thinks, you know what it needs? It needs its own set of wheels and its own motor. So he's trying to save up money for a motorcycle engine to put onto it. And one night during a really strong windstorm, it gets destroyed. And he figures out, you know what? I think maybe the universe is trying to tell me something. So as he gets older, he goes to school, finishes, and joins what back then was the Army Signal Corps, which was running Army aviation at the time. He is an instructor pilot. And mind you, to give you an idea how rudimentary all this was, he became an instructor pilot with only 6 hours of flying time. He had joined the Signal Corps in 1917, so World War I was already underway. And there's a picture of him in 1918 as a flight instructor. He did not get to go overseas in the First World War. So he continues to work as a flight instructor and as a demonstration pilot for the military. And back in those days, following the First World War, promotions were virtually non-existent. So he stayed a lieutenant for about 10 years. He did manage to make first lieutenant. He'd given a lot of aerial demonstrations. It actually earned a bit of a name for himself. And he did wing walking and all kinds of stuff. So he was pretty much involved in every aspect. He did crack up quite a few airplanes, some of them rather seriously. He had to parachute out three times during his career, including during the Doolittle raid. After about 10 years, he had decided that he was pretty much going to be a permanent lieutenant, and he could barely feed his family on those wages. But he had earned quite a name for himself. In fact, in 1922, he did something that probably the first thing he did that really put him on the map. And that was, he flew a biplane from Jacksonville, Florida to California with only one fuel stop and was the first aviator to cross the United States in less than 24 hours. This transcontinental flight really got some excellent press coverage for the military and for Doolittle. And he also worked towards getting his PhD in aeronautics from MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and was in fact only the second person ever to get a PhD in aeronautics. By this point, pretty much everyone had learned that Jimmy Doolittle was an extremely driven individual, but he was not careless or reckless. He did take a lot of risks, but they were always calculated risks. Sometimes they paid off, sometimes they didn't. He was very clear he felt he was able to stay focused on one thing at a time, and when he was flying, that's what he was focused on, and this is probably one reason he was able to get out of so many bad situations. In fact, he became known as the master of the calculated risk. So while he was still in the Army in the mid-1920s, he told the military that, look, they've got this thing called the Schneider Cup. It's a seaplane race. It's international. All the countries are making entrants. They're all backed by their governments and their militaries. It's very prestigious. We should have Curtis build us an airplane for this race. And he, against all odds, he was actually able to raise the money necessary for the military to enter the R3C racers. And it was the R3C2 that was the float plane version that he flew to success in the Schneider Cup. Now, this was his first major race win, and it was an international race. So now, although he was already fairly well known in the United States, now he was pretty much known internationally. And that was done in 1925. The American Aviation Institution was so impressed by his accomplishment that the next year in 1926, they awarded him the McKay Trophy for his win in 1925. The McKay Trophy was given to the American that people thought had done the greatest single aviation feat of the previous year. And since he had beat all the international competition in the Schneider Cup and brought all these accolades to both the United States, Curtiss Aircraft, and the American military, the people thought that he deserved the McKay Trophy. So that one win got him both the Schneider Cup and the McKay Trophy. Doolittle, though, felt that his single greatest accomplishment, which is possibly one of his lesser known ones, but unquestionably his most important one, was in 1929 when, after years of work and research, he mastered what back then was called blind flying. He was the first person to take off on instruments, fly an airplane, return, and land completely on instruments. And this really opened up aviation to genuine air commerce. You didn't have to wait for the weather to be clear to fly. He always held that that was his single greatest contribution to aviation, and I happen to agree with him. But still, he wasn't making enough money to get by, so in 1930, given his notoriety, he was offered a job by the Shell Oil Corporation to help him sell Shell oil products. So he took the job. It was a substantial pay hike. He had access to some very modern aircraft, some of which were even better than the military airplanes, because remember, the military was still operating mostly open cockpit biplanes. And this gave him access to resources that he simply would not have had before. Not to mention Shell was very lenient with giving him time off, so he was able to pursue other things like racing. So in 1931, he teamed up with Matty Laird, and Matty Laird had designed a racing plane called the Solution that Doolittle had had some success in. And Doolittle had flown many other aircraft. Shell Oil bought one of the Travel Air Model R mystery ships that he used for aerial demonstrations. I don't think he took it to any major races, but he did a lot of air shows with it and was very successful with it. He was able to take this Laird Super Solution and win the 1931 Bendix Cross Country Race. And then he went on and took it on to New York and set another record going transcontinental, beating Frank Hawk's record. But of course, aviation is jumping in leaps and bounds at this point, and Matty Laird knew they had to make the airplane go faster to win the following year, so they gave the Super Solution a retractable undercarriage. Unfortunately, after Jimmy Tesla, the gear wouldn't come down. He had to belly land the airplane, and it did enough damage to it, it wasn't going to make the race. Just so happens at the same time, the Granville brothers, who'd enjoyed considerable success with their GB racers, had their pilot in the hospital, and they needed a pilot, so they teamed up. Doolittle goes out to Massachusetts to the Granville brothers, spends about an hour getting a ground briefing on the airplane, takes off and takes it straight to Cleveland for the air races. And he basically learns to fly the plane on the way. And he goes up to a safe altitude, and good thing he did, because on the way over there, he made a few maneuvers of the airplane and immediately did a double snap roll on him. And he realized, and this is a direct quote, he needed to fly the airplane with silk gloves, and he did. So in 1932, he goes to the Cleveland Air Races, enters the airplane, gets an average speed of 296 miles an hour, stays above the rest of the traffic at the race, which is a pylon race, because one, he's going faster than they are, he lapped almost everybody in the race, and two, he had to make wide turns around the pylons. He didn't dare try to hug the pylons like the other guys were doing because the GB would have gone out of control on him. He would later write Zanford Granville a letter saying, you know, thank you, made a wonderful airplane. But he also knew that this airplane was strictly for the experienced race pilot who knew how to fly it. So there was no hope that this airplane was ever going to be anything other than a racing airplane. In fact, most of the GB racers would later crash, killing their pilots. Doolittle's only a handful of people to fly the original ones that survived it and lived on. But after 1932, Doolittle, who was already very well known, is essentially a household name. He's got every major trophy, the Schneider Cup, the Bendix Cup, the Thompson Trophy, and the McKay Trophy. The same day he wins the Thompson Trophy, he adds a little luster to this by taking the record in the Shell Speed Dash. But after the Thompson Trophy race, he learned something that was a little disconcerting. Apparently, the media had been watching his family, and they had cameras at the ready to take photographs of them and their expressions if he was killed. And this made him question whether or not this was something he should stay engaged in. Also, it should be added that racing had pushed the technology. He wasn't really sure that racing and the technological advancements it was making were worth the accidents and the bad press aviation was getting. He wanted aviation to be a professional thing, not turn into a glorified circus stunt. So after the 1932 Cleveland Air Races, he retired from air racing. Now, there could be no question that he was one of the finest pilots out there, absolutely one of the finest air racing pilots. He had set numerous records, and of course they would later be broken, but that was the nature of the times. He had every major trophy. He'd flown virtually every racing airplane, the Mystery Ship, the Super Solution, the GBs, the R3, C2. He'd kind of been there, done that, and he was virtually a household name. Now, while he was working for Shell Oil, he managed to accomplish something that is probably only second to his instrument flying as far as being a major contribution to aviation. And that was, he politicked Shell Oil to make higher octane aviation gasolines, get up over 100 octane or better. And Shell took an understandable attitude of, why would we want to set up this very expensive infrastructure to make this higher octane fuel when there's virtually no engines that can use it? And he rightfully countered with, there are no engines that can use it because the fuel isn't available. So it became a chicken or the egg sort of thing. He got them to make the 100-octane fuel. Once he did, he was able to demonstrate how he could get more power out of the engines, how the engines had more potential for the manufacturers, and sure enough, a couple of manufacturers started making engines to burn this new higher-octane fuel, and of course, more power is delivered for the same weight as a result. And this would give the United States a big edge in the Second World War because we were already set up for higher octane spirits. The importance of this cannot be overstated. So throughout the late 1930s, he's involved doing this. War clouds are brewing over Europe and in Asia. Everyone knows a big war is coming, which is one of the reasons that Doolittle was pushing for these higher octane fuels. But the main thing was he realized he was going to have to go back in the military to really contribute. Now, he'd stayed in the reserves, he'd made major, and was eventually promoted to lieutenant colonel. Then, after a United States naval officer had witnessed American medium bombers making mock attacks on a simulated aircraft carrier airfield that the Navy had, the idea popped in his head, hey, I wonder if those things could get off of an aircraft carrier, maybe be used to go hit the Japanese. And the idea of what would later become the Doolittle Raiders was born. Given Doolittle's background in doing so many experimental things and his vast knowledge, and not to mention his personal acquaintance with a lot of the players involved, he got tapped to go see if this idea might work. He basically had three airplanes at his disposal: the B-26 Marauder, the B-25 Mitchell, and the B-18 Bolo Bomber. The Bolo was too slow and didn't have much in the way of a bomb load. There was no way you were going to get a B-26 Marauder off of a carrier, but the B-25 Mitchell actually carried an adequate payload, adequate speed, pretty straightforward to fly, and it did have the ability to get off a carrier. A test was done on three B-25s were taken out beyond the Horizon aircraft carrier. One had engine trouble, but the other two successfully took off. The guys didn't know what was going on. They thought maybe this is a new idea for delivering aircraft. And by the way, techniques like that were used for delivering aircraft sometimes, just not B-25s. Doolittle finds the highest time B-25 Mitchell squadron he can. The guys with the most experience. Tells them it's a dangerous mission. Everyone volunteers, including the unit commander. And then the Doolittle mission takes place. They train up very hard for it. And of course, there's so many documentaries and it's so well covered that I'm not going to go into any detail here other than Doolittle's Tokyo raid takes place. He has to parachute out of an airplane for the third time. And he makes it back to the United States. Now, he's convinced he's going to be court-martialed. He lost the whole squadron, and he didn't think they did that much damage to the city, but he did not realize what a huge success this was for the American military. Even though they had no intention of ever returning, it forced the Japanese to bring fighter squadrons from combat areas in the Pacific back to Japan to help guard Japan, and of course, a huge morale boost for the Americans. He actually gets the Medal of Honor and skips the rank of colonel and goes straight to brigadier general. But he's not really respected within the military because he's seen as a reservist, not a real full-time officer. Well, you know, Doolittle went off and went and got a high-paying job on the civilian side when things got tough and we all stayed military and starved. So there was a little bit of, I guess the word would be turfism, that would cause him some problems in his career with quite a few of the senior staff, but he got along with a lot of them also. Now, Doolittle had always been a boxer. He'd always been an aggressive guy, but again, master of the calculated risk. He understood his limitations. Now, Doolittle always came across as confident, but not arrogant. He understood his limitations, and this is why he became the master of the calculated risk. That aside, he still had some problems with some of the permanent military brass who just saw him as a reservist. So once he became a general, he started moving towards trying to get his rank made permanent as a regular officer, no longer as a reservist. Meantime, since he was a general, they sent him down to take over the 12th Air Force in North Africa. And he operated there for a while, and then they transferred him to take over the 15th Air Force in the Mediterranean. And a lot of you won't know this, but later in the war, Doolittle actually became the commander of the Mighty 8th, the 8th Air Force. Now, he made a very clear distinction between the other commands in the 8th Air Force. He basically had to help build the 12th and 15th Air Forces almost from scratch. When he got to the 8th Air Force, it had already been built up, so he had a working command that was very large. He looked at what was going on, and one of the big changes he made was he told the fighters of the 8th Air Force they didn't have to stay glued to the bombers anymore. They could go out and rove and look for the enemy. And when this happened, a lot of the American aces started racking up a lot of kills, because before Doolittle took over, the motto of the fighters had been, it's the job of the fighter to protect the bomber. And Doolittle changed this and said, it is the job of the fighter to destroy the enemy air force. And this is when the Luftwaffe started really losing airplanes in big numbers, because now the fighters were out chasing the German fighters back to their air bases, whatever it took. Basically what would later be called seek and destroy missions. So that was a fundamental shift. A lot of the bomber pilots didn't like it. They wanted the fighters close where they could see them. But Doolittle understood that fighters are more effective when they go out and catch the enemy before they can get to you, and then chase them down and destroy them so they can't come back the next day. And this is when the Luftwaffe really started taking it on the chin. Doolittle would eventually go on to become a four-star general, and having both the Medal of Honor and an honorary set of naval aviators wings because of the Tokyo raid, he absolutely became one of the most highly decorated aviators in the history of the American Air Force. Doolittle quit flying because he realized that flying full time, all the time, in all kinds of weather, despite all of his experience, required proficiency. And he always felt that aviation was a vocation, not an avocation. If he wasn't going to do it enough to stay proficient at all times, he wasn't going to do it at all. So he quit flying as the pilot and pretty much never went back to it. He was getting swamped with all kinds of administrative duties, and he realized that this is where he needed to be, what he needed to be doing. And if he was to keep flying in all kinds of weather and all kinds of aircraft and doing test work without staying extremely proficient, something bad was going to happen. So he just quit. Doolittle would go on to serve on countless boards and administrative functions, work for numerous companies, and did very well for himself. He had two sons who both became Air Force pilots. Unfortunately, he suffered one of the greatest tragedies of his life when he lost one of his sons to a suicide. He always wondered if there was something that he had missed or could have done to have prevented that, as any parent would. Years later, his wife, Jo, would pass away, and he never remarried. He would finish out his last few years, clear of mind, living with his other son. He passed away in 1993 at the age of 96. General James H. Jimmy Doolittle is arguably the single most illustrious aviator in the history of the United States, if not the world. He stands beside people like the Wright brothers, Charles Lindbergh, and Neil Armstrong. And I think having been born when he was, lived when he did, and made the decisions that he made in his life that put him in the positions he was in, the name of his book, I Could Never Be So Lucky Again, is apropos. Well, that's a quick look at Jimmy Doolittle. Air race pilot, military aviator, an all-round incredible American. You guys take care. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed this short video. We'll see you next time. And model on.
Thank you.